Hello, I'm Gabriel from LEWITT. I'm here today with Alex Robinson. Hey, Alex.
Hi, Gabriel.
Hi, Dave. Thanks for having us. We're at Metropolis Studios in London, and today Alex will show us how you can make this. Sound like this. So if you want to improve your mixing skills, watching a professional do a mix can definitely be helpful, but nothing can replace the experience of trying it yourself. So if you want to give it a shot, go to the link in the description down below, download the multitracks and try it yourself. So when it comes to mixing, do you have a general approach? Do you have a template with all your buses set up? Do you have stuff from the beginning on the mix bus, or do you like go differently every time?
Yeah, I do have a template which I use. I import my audio first, I've got my source material, and then I import my template. I've got a bunch of different stuff set up. I've got some buses which I run things like, you know, standard things like drums, bass, you know, keys, vocals, synths, you know, all that stuff gets, you know, summed down into buses. And then I've got all my effects, various effects here, which I can just drop in. And then moving to the other side, I've then got these parallel mixes set up, which I can route to. I tend to route, you know, I'll do drum, you know, drum parallel, you know, I've just got stuff set up. So I can, the whole idea behind the template is I can, depending on what it is, I can just drop in any of this stuff. And the last thing I want to be doing when I'm mixing
is
creating buses and routing stuff. And, you know, so for instance, I've got the drum parallel here, and I've got three or four different compressors that I like to try out. I'll drop either one of those in, and then I'll EQ it slightly, maybe add a bit of distortion on the end here, and then that goes to a separate stereo mix for the parallels, and then I've got a mix where all the kind of bus down tracks go to. So I've kind of got my parallels and the mix separate, so I can kind of isolate each one, and then together those go to the mix bus. And I tend to like to get a good balance, so I'm feeling good about the track, and then once it's, you know, kind of in a good place, in a good static balance, yeah, then I'll start to throw some stuff on the mix bus.
So let's dive in. Where do we start?
Cool, yeah. So let's dive straight in with the drums. For this show, and all our shows, we obviously use a combination of LEWITT mics. We use a couple of mics on the kick, a couple of mics on the snare, hi-hat ride, rack floor, so all our spot mics. Then we use the 640 TS for the overheads, which sound amazing. And then we just used a 440 DM for a slam mic or a burst mic.
Okay.
So yeah, we've got a nice kind of spread of mics, lots of different looks, and we'll start putting them together. First thing I'm using is a bit of tape saturation. I'm just using this UAD A800 Studer plugin. Not doing very much, but I'll just play the whole thing to you quickly with and without it, so you can hear it. Just kind of, you know, it's just a bit of tape compression, lightly touching it.
So it's really rather subtle.
It's really subtle, but it just kind of very lightly glues everything together quite nicely. So yeah, starting with the kick, we've got a kick in. I'll just run you through each one individually first. And you can hear all that's doing really is just taking out a few of those kind of lower mids, which are just making it a little bit honky,
yeah.
And it's just tightening up the low end. That's all I really want to do with that, and filter out some of a little bit of the top there as well that is just doing nothing. I'll tend to filter out bottom of top of most things to a point, you know, where they're not going to be useful in the mix, and they could just be adding stuff that I don't want in there. Just get it out straight away. Moving on to the kick out.
So you really just take the low end?
Yeah, you see, as you can see from this one, I've really filtered down quite low. I was quite happy with the kick-in sound to start with, and I know I'm going to use that predominantly anyway. So really all I want from this microphone is just to give it a little bit of, you know, lower end punch. And then those two are then bussed to one kick group. I've got a couple of bits going on here. This nice little plugin from Boz Labs. Gate-to-80. I don't tend to use gates for mixing generally, but for live stuff they can be a bit useful, and I like this one because it can be frequency dependent. I mean, that's
really, really short and
simple. Yeah, that's a bit brutal, but you get the idea. And actually, what the other thing to listen out for is in between the kick hits as well, there's quite a lot of low end rumble.
From
the toms, I think there's, you know, the bass guitar's quite loud on stage as well. So all that stuff. So it's really just cleaned it out. That's why I like this plugin, because you can kind of, you know, you can select what range you want to actually gate. So I've just really gated everything below about 300 hertz here.
Quite obvious.
Yeah, tightens it up. So moving on, once I've done kind of reductive EQ here, taking stuff out using the fab filter, I like to, if I'm doing any additive EQ, you know, use something a bit nicer, kind of a bit posher. So for that, we've got this 1081 UAD plugin, and I think in this one actually all I've done is taken out a little bit more of the lower mids and just boosted a touch around 100 hertz
for the thumb.
Yeah, just to add a little bit more weight to it. And then finally, because, I mean, I've been a bit heavy-handed with the gate there, but just to add a little bit more sustain into the hit as well, just a bit of transient designer, just adding a bit more sustain in. So that's a kick. Mm-hmm. Moving on to the snare. Again, I haven't done too much to these. Filtering out, so this is the snare top. Just filtering out, you know, again, low stuff. Again, because we've got so much going on stage. You want to really kind of try and isolate problem areas and get rid of them. So you can hear that cleans it up quite a bit, especially in the low end. And then I've just done some kind of quite fine notches in areas that will probably, which would have been poking out quite obviously. I'll just give you a quick demonstration of that. Yeah, we don't want that stuff in there. So that's just pulling a bit of that stuff out again. And again, you can see all this stuff is just taking stuff out and getting each individual track to sound as good as it can before we do any other processing to it. Okay, moving on to snare bottom. Similar thing, taking out the bits that I don't want. I mean, I really like this actually. This is the LCT 340, mm-hmm. the pencil mic, oh. And you can hear it's actually got really good rejection of all the. Quite often with, you know, understeer mics, you're fighting the kick drum, and you've got, you know, potential phase issues with everything, with the other snare microphone, and they can just sometimes sound a bit harsh and not particularly useful. But in this instance, it just, you know, it has everything I want in it. I haven't done too much with the EQ, just taken out a few kind of notches in areas that were kind of poking out a little bit, but you know, really sounded pretty good from the get-go.
Just a little bit rounder.
Yeah, just tightened up the top and the bottom. And really all I'm going to use that for is just with the, you've obviously got the crack and the kind of very mid-rangey thump of the top mic. And I want that to bring a bit more life into the higher frequency area of the snare drum. So we don't just end up with a thumpy snare drum. So that's the top. That's the bottom. Then again, they're grouped together. This is them together. And you can hear, quite subtle, but you can hear when I introduce that bottom mic, it just adds a bit more,
presence.
Yeah, it just adds a bit more presence, a bit more of that kind of higher frequency stuff that we want back in the snare to give it its full range. They're both routing to the snare subgroup. And on that, not doing too much, I've got this Fatso Junior UAD plugin, just adding a little bit of warmth and compression. And then finally, just again, an EQ at the end, just to add a little bit more low end into it, just to kind of push up that crack of the snare drum. Quite a fine adjustment, but it's one of those ones I think I'd probably put on once everything was in, and just to get that range of the snare drum 100 hertz, just get the lower end of it just cutting through just a touch more. And that's the snare drum.
Actually quite low, surprising.
In
100 hertz for a snare drum?
Yeah, just...
But I mean, I hear it works, just wouldn't have thought, so...
Hi-hat and ride, we always take these. Sometimes they're useful, sometimes they're not. So for this show, this is actually the first show we used the LCT 040 match pair on hi-hat and ride. And now we talked about this a little bit today. I haven't tried them yet as a kind of matched pair in a stereo configuration yet. I'm looking forward to doing that. But I really like these, and for the price range, I think they're absolutely fantastic. Just very, very clean, very clear. And for spot mics on kind of hi-hat and ride, they're the kind of things that can sound either really horrible or just, you know, when they sound good, they sound good. And these sound natural, which is what you want. Haven't done too much with these. These will sit pretty low in the mix anyway. They go to a group, but really, again, it's just introducing a bit of EQ just to kind of take out anything that's really horrible. You can see on the hi-hat, obviously filtered roll all the way up to about 230 hertz there. And the real top end as well, because no, it's just not something I'm going to need. And then with the ride, a little bit more room is out the front a bit more, so picked up a little bit more of the other stuff going on. But have a listen.
Yeah, much more friendly.
Yeah, you can hear straight away that I think for this show as well, we may, because of the setup of the kit, we may have had to have the mic coming from underneath the ride. So it's quite harsh on the top range. The positioning probably wasn't ideal. That's just one of the things you have to deal with in a live show. But yeah, just filtering out a lot of the top and a lot of these kind of mid-range, you know, 2K, 1K, 3K kind of bits where it can get really, really harsh and unpleasant. Particularly unpleasant. So not much, you know, don't need to do too much to those. Mm-hmm. They are then sent to a group, but I'm not doing anything on that. And like I said, they'll be pretty low down in the mix until needed. Rack and floor. Now, I tend to, in my prep, I don't like to do too much kind of cutting with live shows, but rack and floor is one thing I tend to do, just because for the time they're not being played, with everything going on, you know, on stage,
just be too much.
They just add resonant frequencies because of the nature of what they are, big wooden shells, reverberant shells, that just aren't going to be useful or nice. And you can duck them, but you know, I just tend to, you know, do some cuts, and because I really just want the kind of attack and impact of them, and then because where I've got my overheads as well, I'll just have those at, you know, a good level, so it kind of gels everything together, and you won't hear that kind of quite harsh cut of the toms here. But we'll have a little listen to see what I've done. So nice sounding toms. I think we used the TT-340 on the rack and the Rex 340 because we wanted a little bit more oomph, a bit more low end from the floor tom. So we decided to go for the kick drum mic on that one, which sounds great. Just looking at the rack. Again, bit of EQ, just taking bits out. And you can hear it's really in those lower mids, which kind of make it a little bit muddy. Just pulling those out with the EQ and taking out anything super low or super high, which is going to be useful to us. Mm. So again, similar thing. It's good kind of balance out, but you hear it's a little bit flabby. That kind of brings out all the low end. Sounds a little bit drastic in isolation, but yeah.
In the whole picture,
it definitely works. And then straight after that, just for a bit of additive EQ, I'm just using this mag EQ and just adding a bit of kind of low end in, I think about 65 hertz. Just to give it a bit more weight. And that's it again for the toms. Moving on to the
overheads.
So we've got the 640s here, so we'll just have a listen to the fronts. Okay, and this one, just taking out some of those lower mids again, it's always an area that can kind of get away with you, especially get away kind of from you with drum mixing, because there's so much kind of low information in there, so it always needs a little bit of tidying up, but it's just avoiding the temptation to kind of take it too far, and you end up with a kit, you know, a drum kit that sounds kind of very, you know, low endy, you know, got all the low end and all the top end and nothing else kind of supporting it. So it is a fine balancing act. So I've just taken a little bit out and just tidied these up, and then we just got the backs as well. Yeah, you can hear straight away that obviously that much more roomy. That's just the you know, the back of both the 640s. Again, just allows you to, with those dual outputs, just allows you to get that balance that you want for your mix of the direct and the kind of room sound, which is great.
Is there ever an occasion where you treat the left and right overheads separately, EQ, or is it always for both?
No, I do, unless there's kind of glaring, you know, problems with one side or the other. Again, it's one of those things you just have to judge when you get the files. If they've been recorded nicely, then no, I'll tend to kind of treat them as one thing and not worry too much about doing in, you know, individual, you know, sides, because then you
get carried away.
You can get carried away, and you can just run into, even with great plugins these days, you can run into phase problems. So it's, you know, it's just best to treat it as one thing for me. And that's the backs again. That'll be blended in quite low with the front. So those two 640s, I've just taken out again a little bit of lower mids. But this time I've used the dynamic EQ because I don't want to just pull it straight out. That's what this Pro-Q is great for, the Pro-Q 3. Just being able to pull that out at occasions when the kind of, I think we're just playing the toms here. And those kind of lower mids are getting a little bit too...
boxy.
Yeah, getting away a little bit too much. So it just pulls them back in without pulling them completely out. It's a great thing to have. Let's put these two overheads together. So again, you've got the fronts. And the backs. And then together.
So you kind of use the back diaphragm signal as a room mic addition.
Exactly.
It's interesting. Yeah?
And for me, the stereo imaging of the 640s is what really makes them shine. They sound fantastic. Everything is kind of is where you'd want it and where you'd expect it to be. You know, you can place the hi-hats over there and the ride over there and the toms. You know, everything just sits exactly where you want it, and they sound great together. They really do. You know, a pair of those. So I've got those, and then they get bussed down again to a subgroup for the overheads, and I'm just using an SSL E-series channel strip on this. What am I doing here? Just a little bit of light compression, again using the onboard dynamics. Adding a little bit of high frequency in again, just so the cymbals kind of cut through. That's just at about 6K there, just so those kind of poke through a little bit more. And that's really it for that. Hear that the cymbals just cut through a little bit more, and also doing a little bit, you know, kind of 3 dB of compression to the overheads, just to kind of glue those you know, front and backs together and draw out the rooms a little bit more, and you know, give it that little bit of kick. Okay, moving on to the slam mic.
So this was like placed between the toms above the beater kind of area, or?
Yeah, so where I mean, it's always kind of dependent on the setup a little bit. With a lot of people using kind of two tom setups, rack and floor, these days, I like to try and get it in kind of where you've got your kick drum and say my snare drum here, kick drum in front of me and my rack tom. I'll get it sitting above the kick drum, you know, a few inches off the top of that, just pointing a little bit towards the snare drum, but just not, you know, so it's what I want it to do is really pick up
shells.
Yeah, shells. That's what I want that to do, pick up shells, and then I can kind of treat those, and it's really there just to kind of make all, you know, make the transient cut through a little bit more. depending on how you treat that. And I think I would have used an 1176 for this on probably an 8 or 12 to 1 ratio. Sometimes I go all buttons in, and these are the kind of things, these mics, they'll either, sometimes they'll sound absolutely brilliant and they'll work, and other times they'll useless. Just sound like absolute trash. So it's
so
always,
this time it worked though.
Yeah, I was quite pleased with this one. It's not, you know, it's not too aggressive, but definitely it's doing its job. It doesn't sound the prettiest in isolation, but when it's blended in with the rest of the drums, it's just helping those transients kind of pop through a little bit more. Again, I've kind of got into this one quite a bit with the EQ. You can see it's doing quite a lot of, taking out a lot of this mid-range here, kind of 1K, between 1K and kind of 500 hertz. And it just, taking that out, it just kind of brings it back into focus a little bit for me. It just sounds a little bit kind of muddy and kind of lost with all that in. Yeah, and then you can hear a bit of a notch of 4.5K there just to take out some of that kind of horrible upper mids. A bit of EQ. Again, a little bit of shaping with Transient Designer. You can see I've taken the attack down a little bit, just take the edge off, and then brought out the sustain a bit more as well.
Yeah, that's makes sense.
And then let's... So what I'll do now is I'll just play you everything that we've just listened to without the slam, and then I'll just introduce that gradually so you get an idea for that. So you can hear it just brings out a bit more sustain of the kit and just helps the attack of the transient a little bit more.
Cool.
I'm pleased with that one. That's worked well on this occasion. So everything we've just heard has now been routed down to the drum bus. I'll use for this, you know, it's a big noisy rock band. I want to get the drums kind of pumping a bit more, and I want them to be kind of aggressive. So I'll use a combination of compression and some nice saturation, kind of harmonic distortion, just to get them sounding big, aggressive, and kind of in your face, really. So the first thing I'm using is this BX Townhouse Bus Compressor. Just doing 4-to-1 ratio, slightly, you know, slower attack, and fairly quick release. And again, this is quite a subtle thing, but it's just to kind of get the drums pumping a little bit. So you can hear it's only doing a couple of dB, really, when the kick and the snare kind of hit in, but it just compresses it nicely and just makes it sound a bit more aggressive. And then finally, just this black box plugin, again by Plugin Alliance. This is just
tube,
adding a
tube saturation.
Yeah, just a bit of tube saturation to make it a bit more aggressive, really.
Also brightens it up.
Yeah, I mean, you can hear straight away there's a little bit more gain in there, but you can hear brightens it up and really just makes it aggressive and in your face, which is exactly what we want on this occasion. And that is our kind of finished drum sound, really. Okay. So The last thing I'll do with the drums really is using my parallel buses, just send a little bit of the shells to the parallel again, just to kind of boost the transient, just to make sure that's really poking through with all the kind of compression and stuff you do. You don't want to lose that transient. So I'm just sending from the kick group, snare group, and then just the toms, just sending to my mix A parallel over here, which is for my drums. And I'll just give you a quick overview of what that's doing. So now all we're listening to now is the parallel. And you hear transient designer there, just to over-exaggerate the transient there, because I know I'm gonna stick a compressor on it as well, just to draw it out. So I'm gonna kind of push the transient into the compressor a bit, so I don't, when I'm compressing it again, lose that transient. But this is all about just, like I say, making those transients pop out, mm-hmm. and then blending that back in with the original drum sound. And you can just hear straight away, it just sounds snappy, you know, sharp, punchy transient without kind of sounding, you know, really cut off and horrible. Final little bit of EQ just to tuck it in, and then a bit of devil lock, just again, bit of saturation, just to kind of make it poke out even a bit more. So one of those things doesn't sound particularly nice on its own, but for the purposes of what we want, just feeding in and, you know, giving the kit a bit more punch.
And then you mix it into taste.
Exactly. So that's the drums by themselves, and now I'll slowly blend in that parallel. And that's my drum sound.
Cool.
Moving on into our bass. And they've got quite a distinctive sound for this, for their bass guitar in this track. And again, this isn't something I'd normally do, but especially for a live show, but I've actually cut the bass because it kind of cuts in and out quite sharply in places as well. I mean, it looks brutal, but it definitely works in this instant. It's one of those things you just have to judge when kind of cutting, you know, bass and, you know, guitars, just cutting the extraneous stuff. In this sense, it's definitely cleaned it up a bit. It's just being careful not to kind of be too hard on it. And you can hear straight away, yeah, it's, you know, it's very specifically kind of
like a synth.
Synth bass kind of thing, to sit, you know, just under that guitar line. And we took a mic and a DI. I think we used the Rex 640 on the cab. So I'll give you a little play of that. And then the DI. So let's have a look at the mic first.
I see your favorite range again.
Yeah, my favorite range. Yeah, right in there, that mid range. Just scoop some of that out, and the lower mids, and taken, I think, with this being the live mic as well, taking some of that top out, which I'm just not gonna use. So let's have a listen to what that's doing. So, and you can hear, obviously this filter is taking out quite a bit of the kind of spill, which we don't want in there. I could probably even drag that down further. And I know for the purposes of this, that I'm going to want the mic to do most of the low end, and then the DI to do kind of a bit more of the mid-rangey, part of the bass. Which is why I've been a bit more aggressive on it. And even you can see I've even filtered a little bit down here with bass instruments and, synth bass and all different kinds of bass sounds. You've always got to be aware of what the real low frequencies are doing. The number of times I'll kind of get a pop track and have a synth part doing the low end, and I'll just put a filter on the low frequency, and actually it'll make it sound bigger because there's stuff going on in the real sub frequency range that
just
is interfering and causing phase issues. So yeah, quite often I'll always put a filter on there and just take anything out that people
not really
just
musical.
Not going to hear, but it could still be causing problems.
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit of filtering on the low end there, and then a bit of. Just adding a little bit more low end, probably. Yeah, as I was saying before, I really just want the mic to do the really low end stuff. So just adding a bit more low end there, and you hear it just tightens up and also gets rid of a bit more of of the higher frequency stuff, and then after that, just compressing it with this multiband compressor. Just to keep with the bass, I tend to compress it and even limit it pretty heavily, just because I want it to be the foundation. I just want it to really sit there.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just doing with this multiband compressor, doing a few dBs of reduction on the low end.
Just a little.
Yeah. Again, it's one of those things, it's quite subtle, but it just helps kind of control what's going on down there. Okay, I'll have a little look at the DI. I'll listen to it without the EQ on. So that's really just, it's quite a wide kind of notch there, but I want to kind of pull out some of that stuff that's sounding
noisy.
A little bit, yeah, nasally and harsh, but not kind of kill their sound and what they're trying to achieve. So again, just, about 5 dB. And also I've used the kind of dynamic EQ there as well, so that it's only when it is kind of in that range, when he's playing with that effect on, that it kind of draws more of that out. So just the EQ on that individually, and then I'll blend in the mic. So you can hear then those two tracks are doing very different jobs, but the combination, you've got the mid-range and kind of all the effect that he's generating with his kind of synth pedal there, and then all the low-frequency stuff and, getting the blend right, and that's your bass sound. They then go to a bass group where we just do, again, a bit of saturation, and I'm really kind of getting into you know, some more kind of extreme limiting, because like I said, I want to pin that bass sound down so it, you know, it doesn't move really too much dynamically. So it's the Massey limiter, not doing too much, but that just holds the bass guitar where it is. And then in with a
tube again.
Bit of tube saturation. Brings out that mid-range a bit, which is nice. Yeah, and then just with the pull tech here, or I'm just adding in again a little bit more at 100 hertz just to kind of make it cut through. This is probably something I adjusted again once everything was in, just to, you know, I'll tend to do my subtractive EQs in isolation as I'm going through the channels, and then once everything is in and I've got a balance, I'll then kind of add EQs at the end and kind of balance everything together to get it sitting exactly where I want it to. Just so I'm not working in solo and in isolation all the time. I tend to start off that way, going through stuff and just cleaning it up. And then once everything's in,
bring it together.
You know, use my nice posh EQs just to kind of make nice fine adjustments. Here, that's getting really bassy now. And the last thing I think I do is just take out a little bit of the really low end again, because it's probably with the pull tech. It sounds great. But obviously it's quite a broadband stroke, so I've just used the API here just to tame the really sub bit of it again. Yeah, so that's our bass sound. I'll just play the bass sound with and without the plugins. So we're adding a little bit of gain there, but you can hear it's just big, fat, aggressive. Again, everything we want from the bass. And now I'll play a bit of the drums and bass together.
Question.
Yes.
Do you ever, in terms of rock music, sidechain the bass with the kick, or is it something that's like,
It really depends on the track. I have done, and if I do, it's very, very subtle. I don't want there to be a great big hole as soon as the kick drops in. I would possibly consider doing it for something like this, because the kick and the bass are sharing a bit of the same frequency range, although I'd probably move the bass up a little bit more once the whole mix is in. But yeah, I'd never rule anything out when it comes to mixing. If it works, it works. No, not for this track today.
Okay.
So there you have it. You got your drums and your bass, and for me, they're both kind of sitting nicely. They sound kind of very much live. You got the live element, but kind of doing their job, sitting in their frequency ranges, and they both sound punchy and aggressive and really,
really
kind of building that house, but yeah, not fighting with each other. Moving on, let's have a look at the vocals.
I hear your bones creaking. I hear your bones creaking. I hear your bones creaking.
So yeah, you got the two vocalists here, Kitty and John. And for this show, we would have used the MTP 940s, the handheld mics. I think they sound great, those mics. Anyway, one thing you do have when you're working with live singers is it's just getting that balance right. And one thing these mics are great at is isolating the vocal. You'll hear in isolation even with a drummer, and I could promise you he played really heavy. The spill is, you know, is really low. It's great. The isolation they provide is fantastic. The trade-off is when you've got, and in this instance, a rock band, and these guys get into it on stage. They really do. They're a great live act to watch. But when you move off that, you know, capsule, when you move around, you will get the vocal kind of coming in and out a little bit. It's just always a bit of a balancing act with these things. I'd rather have the isolation and kind of deal with some of the proximity and, you know, the movement of the vocalist in post for the live show. But we can have a listen. This, I think, is Kitty. And I mean, you listen to that, and like I said, the drummer is about a meter behind her, absolutely hammering it, and the spill. I mean, you can hear the drums, but
not the big drum.
You know, the vocal is right there, and you've got a bit of drums. So, I mean, for me, that's fantastic, and that's what makes those mics some of the best vocal mics I've used, especially, you know, for the balance of the quality of the sound, and then the isolation is incredible. So, yeah, straight away, you've got a great source to work with. So that was Kitty. We'll have a little listen to John.
Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Why are your bones creaking? Why are your bones creaking?
Very cool. So I would have used a fairly similar kind of approach for both these vocals. There's very little bit between kind of doing a live mix and, you know, working with an actual kind of produced track in terms of, I want to kind of make sure that vocal in the live mix kind of stays as full as possible, especially when they're moving around so much. So we'll just hear both those vocals with a bit of EQ on.
Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking.
Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking.
And again, it's really just kind of with this first EQ, just taking out the bits that we don't want in there. So you can hear a couple of frequency notches. You can hear, especially in Kitty's, it really kind of tightens up the low end and gets rid of some of that muddiness, which you're always going to get with a live vocal, especially. And similarly for John's as well. Then a bit of compression. I'm using a couple of compressors in series here.
Quick first and then slow, or?
Sorry?
First for something for the quick stuff and
then. Yep, exactly that. And I mean, I do it like that, you know, using different compressors for different jobs. I've got this 1176, which, you know, they're super fast compressors and, you know, obviously studio classics. Just doing very kind of quick attack and release, just catching those parts of the vocal, especially in the quite aggressive style that they've got. You know, you can get away on you pretty quickly. So that's just to bring some of the higher peaks down. And then after that, this LA2A just to smooth it out. And it's the kind of thing with digital plugins, kind of versus the hardware. I get asked a lot, you know, which one I kind of prefer. But I really treat them as two different things. As good as the plugins are, they are still a very different thing. And it's really more noticeable, I find, when you start pushing plugins to their extremes. You know, doing small amounts of compression with a plugin will sound fairly, you know, similar to how the hardware reacts. But when you really start to push a, you know, I can get a lot more out of a real LA-2A. It'll sound much more natural if it's doing 5-7 dB of gain reduction versus the plugin. So I might use a couple in series to do, you know,
small increments.
You know, do 3 dB of gain reduction with each to get to 6 versus doing 6 on one hardware unit. You know, okay. It's that kind of thing, really. But in this instance, yeah, I've got two to do. One to do the quick, you know, to bring the peaks down, and then the second just to smooth the whole thing out. So this is just the 1176 in.
Ah, your bones creaking! 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 Ah, your bones creaking!
So just makes it sound, you know, fills out a voice a bit, makes it sound a bit kind of bit bigger, and just controls it dynamically just a little bit. And then adding in the LA-2A.
Ah, your bones creaking! 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 Ah, your bones creaking!
So it's a little bit like fader riding?
Yeah, exactly, a little bit. Then just a little bit of saturation.
Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your...
Again, sounds a little bit fuller, just adds a little bit to that mid-range. Makes it prettier. In a kind of distorted, dirty way. Okay, then we've got a multi-band compressor, and this I'm just controlling some of the mid-range and high frequency stuff, just to, you know, really kind of help it sit there. I've used a preset here, and then I've just kind of tightened up the frequency ranges a little bit, so we'll just have a little listen to that.
Ah, your bones creaking! 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 Ah, your bones creaking!
Again, just controlling the kind of top range of the vocal, quite subtle. And then finally, the last bit, again, for more for the live stuff than, you know, the produced tracks, but just using vocal rider for when she's moving around on the mic a little bit. But really, I've got this set to, I think, a range of about, you know, 3 dB. So it's not, you know, I don't want it to be kind of super obvious what it's doing. So it's really quite subtle, but just helps kind of control that vocal a bit so it doesn't disappear on us in sections.
Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your bones creaking! Ah, your bones creaking! Ah.
So when she's running out, not running out of air, but the last words.
Yeah, exactly. It's just drawing that out a little bit more. So yeah, this is the final part that I would have added once everything's in, just adding that EQ in and just kind of balancing it in with everything else. And just to sweeten it up, just to kind of 5K range here, just add a little bit. And taken out a little bit, kind of the lower mids again as well, where it's kind of, it's still a little bit kind of, you know, honky in the lower mids there. So we'll have a listen to that.
Ah, your bones creaking! 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 Ah, your bones creaking!
There we go. And that's Kitty's vocal. And I mean, the process for John's would be pretty much the same, just obviously treated slightly differently because he's got, you know, different range, but you know, fairly similar process in terms of having the 76, then the LA-2A, a bit of distortion. And I think just in terms of the, just use a slightly different plug-in EQ at the end there, slightly more surgical one. So we'll just hear that kind of in and out.
Your bones creaking, now your bones creaking. Why your bones creaking? Why your bones creaking? Why your bones creaking? Now your bones creak out. Now your bones creak out. Now your bones creaking. Now your bones creaking. Now your bones. Now your bones creaking. Now your bones creaking.
And then both of them in together.
Now your bones creaking. Now your bones creaking.
And then I'll just drop all the plugins out so you can kind of see where we started and where we've ended up.
Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking.
So we've got the clarity. You know, they sound good. They sound aggressive. That's everything we want from them, really. So the next kind of step is to, you know, give them a bit more space in the mix using effects. So rather than just using kind of one reverb or one delay, I like to kind of use, you know, combinations of reverbs and delays to really kind of generate that space and get it kind of sitting where I want it to. So I've got a bunch of sends kind of set up here. The first one I've got, I am using a vocal parallel. I'll just explain that quickly. Same thing as I did with the drums, really, and that's just sending over to my vocal channel here. So I'll play you the vocal, and then I'll just drop the parallels in.
Your bones creaking. 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 Your bones creaking.
Again, quite subtle, but yeah, you can really hear it.
Just stable.
Yeah, just really holds the vocal there a little bit, but quite subtle. Then straight after that, I think we've got a combination of reverbs. I've used a plate and a chamber here. I've used probably, what have we got? At the moment, I'm quite fond of, where is it? Yeah, the Sound Toys, the little plate. Sounds great. Been using that for quite a while at the moment. Just a little delay, pre-delay there before that, just to kind of separate the reverb from the vocal a little bit.
Your bones creaking. 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 Your bones creaking.
So again with this, I've got some really good stuff from the room mics, which I'll get to in a bit. But I just want to add, it's not the kind of thing I want to wash in reverb. So the plate's kind of quite subtle. It's not doing too much, but just giving it a little bit of space.
Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones.
And something that I find key, which you know, sometimes gets forgotten, is always EQing your effects as well. So that's the plate, and then we've got this chamber, which is just the Wave Abbey Road chambers.
Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking. Your bones creaking.
And one of the things that one of the kind of main mix notes I had or instructions from these guys was a lot of slap vocal, slap delay on the vocal. So that's what I've gone for here. And I think I've used a couple of different kind of slap delays for the vocal in this particular track. But this was this one, especially with the chambers, kind of the main effect here. And you hear with the combination of both the chamber and the plate. To create the kind of reverb space for this particular track.
Your bones creaking. 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 Your bones creaking.
So straight away, just kind of, they're kind of sat in that space, but they've not kind of disappeared into the, you know, in the effects either. Okay. So yeah, this is the main kind of delay I'm using on the vocal. It's the Echo Boy. I'm using a preset, the Dirty Slow. And I just all I've done here is really ramped up the kind of saturation on it as well, because I want to have that slap delay, but also, you know, the whole thing. I want it to sound aggressive, and, you know, going to use lots of distortion and saturation in this track to get it sounding that way. So I'm using that in the effects as well. So just give you a quick look at that. Yeah, so you get the idea. And then after that is just this distortion reverb. It's just a distorted reverb that I've added in. Again, bit of saturation and bit of devil lock there, because we like lots of distortion in this track. It kind of brightens up that's more of a room, kind of room sound on the reverb, but just kind of brightens up a little bit, and kind of makes with the other reverbs in as well. You've kind of got that full range, just kind of lets the reverb poke through a little bit more, and sits nicely with their vocals. Okay, so we've looked at drums, bass, we've got the vocals in now. It's all kind of, it's starting to come together a bit. We'll just have a listen to where we're at the moment. Next, and very important to this track, is guitars. Again, similarly with the bass, because of the big kind of boombastic sound when the guitars kind of cut in and the bass cut in and out, I wanted to really exaggerate that kind of sense of them kind of coming in and dropping out. I have cut the guitars as well, so we kind of get a bit more sense of that. The other thing I wanted to do with the guitars as well, because we are just dealing with a single channel, I don't want them to just kind of sit in the middle, because we're not using up any of the space at the moment. So I have bust them out, and I've got a few effects to kind of make them a little bit wider and a little bit bigger. This is the guitar. In terms of the actual guitar, I think I've just taken out a little bit of the lower mids because it was getting a little bit muddy in there. So I'll just have a quick listen to that. Again, making use of the dynamic EQ just to kind of, you know, make sure it doesn't cut them completely and it all sits nicely. Then after that, it's kind of sending to this aux here, this guitar aux, which we've got a few effects going on. I've basically got a Telray delay going on here. Let's have a listen to that.
Yeah.
again, this is quite subtle, but it's just to just adding that delay just to kind of fill out the sound a little bit, and then I can use this ozone stereo imager just to spread that out a little bit. And just a bit of EQ, and it's again, it's one of those things. It's just trying to, it's quite subtle, but it's just trying to kind of spread the guitar out a bit more and fill up the speakers. I'm going to bring the, yeah, I got it on a pre, so we'll just take the main guitar out. So we're just listening to this affected guitar now. Quite a change, it's quite aggressive, but what I want to do is really get the mid-range of that guitar out on the wings. The, you know, all the low end's really going to sit in the middle and spread out a bit more of the kind of mid-range and higher frequency stuff out to the sides. So that's why that's kind of a bit more filtered. Again, it's quite a subtle thing blended in, and then just a widening plug-in on the end. So you can see there, it's again quite a subtle effect, but it just spreads it out a little bit and just makes it sound a bit fuller. And then those two are then bussed together, and we just, again, using combination of kind of saturation and compression. I really like using this Renaissance Axe compressor by Waves on guitars. Again, just not doing much more than about 3 dB of reduction, but that really kind of makes it sit nicely. Just holds it there, and then on the guitar group, we've got some saturation, and then some EQ just to kind of make it sit where I want it to, with everything else that's going on. Use this API EQ. I mean, they sound great, these EQs, just to kind of make that sit in with the rest of the track. You can hear as I drop that aux out how the kind of it's quite a tight slap delay on the guitar there, has just kind of, it helps generate a bit of space for the guitar out on the sides there. Yeah, a bit of compression, and that's about it for the guitar. I've kind of, once I've got that balance, I then EQ'd it just to find its own space in the mix. We go from the guitar with no effects on. Do a bit of this. I hear you. So it's really about, I mean, I don't want to interfere with this tone too much because it sounds, you know, the guitar sounds great and they have a very distinctive sound, but it's just kind of beefing up what's already there. Then lastly, we've just got this organ part, which is just in a couple of sections, find at the beginning here. They had this going through an amp, which sounded fantastic. So we took a mic for it, which was a 440 DM, and then we took a DI as well, just to have that safety as there as well. But we'll have a listen to it in isolation.
I guess that's the DI, the high end.
That was the combination. This is just the mic. Yeah, that was a direct signal.
That's kind of funny.
Yeah, I mean, they were quite kind of specific about really using just mainly the amp. I have blended in just a little bit of the DI after the
we
fact.
Won't tell them.
Yeah, it's fine. I think they know that anyway. But yeah, so you've got, I always take a DI just for safety. So we've got that just EQ'd a little bit, but the combination of the two sounds, that amp sounds fantastic. But again, a mono signal, and it was really important not to have everything crowding the center of the mix. I've used kind of a ping pong delay just to kind of get it out on the sides a bit more. You'll see the effect that brings. Quite a short delay, you know, seven and a half and then 30 on the other side. But that's really just to kind of spread it out. Apart from that, just a bit of saturation because we love using that. Again, little bit of compression, but not doing too much. And some EQ, just taking out the bits we don't want, the really high frequency stuff. And again, in that kind of mid-range, upper mid-range of the organ there, which is quite aggressive. I don't want it to kind of get away too much, so. Maybe a touch heavy, but yeah, there or thereabouts. And then finally, again, just using, once I'd brought everything else in, I would have used a little bit of the API EQ just to kind of get it seeing exactly where I want it in the mix. And there we go. That's all the individual elements, and we'll have a listen to everything together now. That's all the main elements. The only other thing that we can look at, let's have a little look at the rooms. These two mics, we would have used the 540S, and they would have been right at the back of the room. And that's just to give us a little bit of ambience. Obviously, you've got a great big PA firing directly into them, which isn't ideal. But sometimes that helps glue everything together really nicely, and other times it's just a bit of a mess. But we'll have a listen to that.
Can you just show us what you did with the EQ?
Oh yeah, of course. So with the room mics, the EQ again, because it's got, like I said, it's got PA firing directly into it. It's just a case of kind of controlling, taking some of that low end out, and And also, I felt like some of the cymbals, that real high-frequency stuff was getting away a little bit, so we'll just have a little listen with that and without it. So we'll have a listen to that, and I'll have, bring the mix up, and then I'll just blend that in, I'll take it past, and then bring it back down. Again, just one of these kind of subtle things. It just helps bring everything together a bit. Without it, it sounds all right, but it all sounds a little bit isolated. But that just helps kind of bring the whole mix together. So yeah, pretty pleased with those. At this point, we've been through all the tracks with kind of, you know, I've got my balance sitting where I want it to sit. And the at this point, I would introduce my mix bus. I tend to start off with this Fairchild emulation. And this is, I'm not actually even doing any compression with this.
It's just for tone.
It's just for tone. Just, you know, just using it as a line amp, basically. It just adds a nice kind of little low-end bump, which I've kind of got used to working with. After that, I've got a limiter, and this is I'd level match the kind of the gain and the input and the output of this. And this is really just to kind of hold in any kind of, you know, peaks that are really jumping out. So it's not doing more than like a couple of dB, and it's set with quite a fast attack and release time. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. You move like a ghost, but I don't see you. I hear you breathing. I hear you breathing. I hear your bones creaking. And again, that's just to really tuck it in a little bit. It's quite subtle, but just helps me get the mix kind of sounding a bit bigger. Then this is again using the Townhouse Bus Compressor, you know, the SSL emulation, and this is really just to add that kind of last bit of glue to the mix. Got this on quite a, you know, 2-to-1 ratio, and then a kind of slower attack, and, you know, slower release, or I've got it on auto in this case, but again just to kind of get it moving and pumping the right way. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. You move like a ghost, but I don't see you. I hear you breathing. I hear you breathing. I hear your bones creaking. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room.
And you do this after the limiter so that it doesn't...
Yeah, exactly. I want the limiter just to kind of, you know, again, like I say, it's quite subtle, and it just brings the, you know, the peaks in a little bit. And then this is just really for character and the movement. Mm-hmm. You know, it kind of, the compression on it just makes it a little bit more exciting. Then I've got a couple of saturators after this. This is Event Horizon, and I'm using the soft clip on it, which is just adding, you know, it's adding its saturation in. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. You move like a ghost, but I don't see you. I hear you breathing. I hear you breathing. Again, quite subtle, but I like to use a combination of saturation. And then this is the Brainworks, the BX saturator, the V2. And really, I'm just saturating the, you know, using a bit of saturation on the sides of the mix with this. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. You move like a ghost, but I don't see you. I hear you breathing. I hear you breathing. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. As I said, that's more on the side, so you can really hear what it's kind of bringing out the sides a little bit more. And then finally, using the Dangerous Backs EQ and just giving it, you know, a little bit of a boost on the high and low end. We'll have a listen to that. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. You move like a ghost, but I don't see you. I hear you breathing. I hear you breathing. I hear your voice. Just beefs up body. The bass, a little bit more body, a bit more weight, and really kind of gets that mix sitting where we want it to sit. Okay, so the final part of this mix bus, after my EQ there, is, as we talked about earlier on, we've got quite a lot of mono information in this track. So I'm just using the ozone imager, which is great because you can split it into frequency bands, and just very subtly just spreading out the mix a little bit, and I'll just drop it in and out so you can get an idea. But I really just the kind of lower and upper mids, I've just kind of spread them out very subtly. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. You move like a ghost, but I don't see you. I hear you breathing. I hear you breathing. You move like a ghost. You move like a ghost across the room. And that just helps me kind of, you know, really spread the mix out. I really want to take full advantage of, you know, the stereo width and the depth of any mix that I'm doing, and try and kind of, you know, use up all the space. So yeah, that's the whole process really, from start to finish.
So can we take a listen to the whole thing?
Yeah, let's have a listen. Cool.
Yeah.
So, that was it for today. I hope you had fun. A big, big thank you to St. Agnes for letting us use their song. The debut album, Welcome to Silvertown, just recently released, and you should definitely go check it out. It really rocks. If you have any questions or a topic that you want us to cover in a future video, please leave a comment below. And if you like this video, you might consider giving us a like. Not because I get high on likes, but because the algorithm demands it. So, have fun. See you next time.